12 of you, okay? That's pretty good. Amen. I'm excited about the Lord. I'm excited what He's going to do tonight. I shared with the men tonight that as soon as I woke up this morning, God said, hey, He wants to do something tonight, and I believe we're going to see God move in a mighty way tonight. Would you agree with me?
Amen.
Amen. I believe that with all of my heart. So I just want us to open up, and I just want us to sing out to the Lord. Amen? Amen? Oh, good, good. We're getting better on that already, I can tell. That's better. Now, this song, you probably don't even know it, but just hum along with us, all right? Well, some glad morning when this life is over, I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away. Well, I'll fly away to glory. I'll fly away in the morning when I die. Hallelujah, by and by. I'll fly away. Just a few more weary days again, and I'll fly away. Big hand clap. Thursday night. Come on, church. Come on now. Amen.
Y'all can have a seat real quick. And Brother David just said it's Thursday night.
Amen.
That means we got tonight and tomorrow night. So we want to be really praying and trusting God that He'll really do something tonight. He's already been doing things, but we want to really be praying that the Spirit of God will be welcome here in this place. All right, Psalms 85, verse 6, ask a question. Will you not revive us again that your people may rejoice in you? God is so good to us, isn't He?
Amen.
Do you rejoice like you should? I don't really think that we do all the time. And that's one reason why we have these revival meetings. But we have many things to rejoice about. And isn't it beautiful out there? And look around you. Are these not the finest people in the world right here?
Amen.
And look at this revival team. It don't get no better than this. Amen. Amen. Will you not revive us again that your people may rejoice in you? All right, now, tomorrow evening we will be having a memorial service here at 6 o'clock for Brother Aaron Gage's daughter, okay? 6 o'clock, and he's going to be leading this. So be praying for him. That's going to be tough, be doing your own daughter's service. And then he has ordered pizza in to be delivered at 8 o'clock. Now, you don't have to be done at 8 o'clock. Pizza be done. Be fine. But he wants us to eat over there in the new building, and he's ordered 50 pizzas. So he must be expecting a lot of people. So, but his daughter's favorite food was pizza. So anyway, come and be a part of that. Be praying for him. And then don't forget about the love offering. I know I get tired of talking about it. If y'all would just give a great big giant love offering. I mean, if Joy said, look, the bank said they can't hold no more money, then that'd be different.
Yeah,
you know. But that's not the case. But we know that God's going to meet their needs, whether y'all give or not. But I'd sure like to get in on the blessings that God's going to give them and go with them as they leave here. So we just appreciate y'all so much. Brother Stephen, I'm going to be praying for you. Did y'all enjoy him last night?
Yeah.
Let's encourage him one more time. Yeah, you did a good job. And I think they're saltier tonight than they was the night before. But anyway. Thank you. All right, let's pray and we'll get back to it here. Father God, we just love you and we thank you for how you love us. And Father, we want to do what you have called us to do here at this church, Lord, in this area. We want to be faithful, Father. We want to be salt and light to a lost and dying world. We want to be the best Bible that anybody will ever read, Father, if that's all they get to see about you is in us. Father, we have failed you so many times, and we ask you to forgive us, Father. And Father, I just pray, Lord, that you would continue to grow us, Lord, spiritually. And Father, we pray that you would continue to grow us in numbers. And Father, we thank you so much for this revival meeting that you blessed us with. We thank you so much for David and his Penny and their Stephen, Lord. We thank you for their faithfulness, Lord, and for how you blessed them with talents, Lord, and sweet personalities. Thank you that we can call them our brothers and sisters in Christ. Father, I pray for every person here tonight, Lord. I pray that you would help us to focus on what's happening tonight. That we would let down any walls of pride in our life tonight, Father.
who was and is and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you.
Afternoon, we were in doing some singing, and I shared with the men today that it's just been good to sit still, just to be still for a little while. You know, sometimes when we get still, God really begins to speak. We really begin to hear from Him. I was thinking about this song. All the things and all the problems that Satan wants to remind us of has been covered in the blood of Jesus, if you know Him as your Lord and Savior. I want you to hear this song. It's entitled, He Covered It All. Thank you.
and he covered it all.
Give the Lord a big hand clap of praise. Amen. Boy, I love the message of that song, and I'm thankful that he covered it all. Didn't anything go uncovered. I mean, when you're washed in the blood, it covers it all.
Right.
Not anything left out. He doesn't say, well, I'll cover this, but I won't cover that. My friend, when he covers us from the top of our head to the sole of our feet. And I think we ought to just say, thank you, Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So I ask you this question. Are you on the battlefield since you're covered in the blood?
Amen.
Oh. Preacher is.
Preacher is. Okay. Woo. My goodness, we just sang about being covered in the blood. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. And so, look here. I think we need to stand up. You can't go to war sitting down. Okay? So here's what we're going to do. If you know the chorus of this song, you sing along with us. But I had to get you standing up because I was afraid that you was going to go to sleep. All right? Are you okay?
Amen.
Amen. Because I'm on the battlefield for my Lord. give the Lord a big hand clap? Come on now. Oh, by the way, this is your shield and your sword right here. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. And we've been talking about this week a lot of things. And so you go ahead, Pete.
First of all, all week long, Brother Andy has stood up here and told us how much you love.
Thank you.
I wanted to share some more. I had Stephen get some things ready right there. A lot of times you think that what you do doesn't impact. That's just a fraction. That's just a fraction. When you sow a seed into the kingdom of God, I want you to look at this map. This was the seeds that y'all sown. Look how many miles that is. The people that are in between every one of those. The places that it's been. Your seeds have been sown all across the United States. And oh, by the way, there's some that's been sown in the Bahamas. Some in Progreso, Mexico. Cozumel, Mexico. Jamaica. All over your seeds have been sown. This was really heavy on our heart because I want Green Valley, the Crusaders want Green Valley to know where you have sent us. Because of the seeds that you have sown into the ministry, they're bringing a crop.
Amen.
So one of these days, when we get into heaven and God says, come here, I want to show you what your seed did. Go to that next slide. Because of your seeds, we get to go to this. This is in Hoopa, California. You see the grass, there's nothing left. It's the forest fires were within 15 miles of there last year when we were there. This is a little church that's out there. When I called the pastor, he was a young man. He's been pastoring that church for about 3 years. He's 26 years old. And Hoopa is probably, Gore is a metroplex compared to Hoopa. And there's a parsonage behind that house, the church there. And they pastor at this little church. And so we sang there on a Wednesday night last year, did a service. And when you talked about having this Wednesday night service in the fellowship hall, that's where they have their Wednesday night service at, in the fellowship hall, because they have a swamp cooler. They don't have air conditioning there. They have it's a water cooler, swamp cooler. So he said, we're going to go to the fellowship hall because it's got a cooler in it. So I just thought, well, they call an air conditioner cooler. So we're unloading the stuff, and he's opening up the windows. I'm closing the windows. He's opening the windows up. He said, you're going to have to leave the windows open because that's how it cools. And I'm like, really? And he began to explain to me, you know, I knew what a water cooler was, but he kept calling the swamp cooler. But this little church, the seeds that have been sown carried us to Hoopa, California. There could be picture after picture and face after face that we could go through and display. But probably one of the faces that speaks in my heart is this next slide. That's Sequoia. Sequoia lives on the Yurok Tribe Reservation. Sequoia is being raised by her great-grandmother because her parents are both in prison with drugs, alcohol. This is inside the little church there. And Sequoia comes to church. And right beside the church is a house that there are three generations that live in that house. And it looks like a wrecking yard around the house because when something quits there, they just let it set. They don't get it out of the way. You even got to drive around it in the road. But there are two great-grandbabies. And every morning, because our bus was parked from about here to their house as to where we're parked right now. Every morning you'd see them out playing in the road, not really dressed, running around their underwear, playing. And they'd get ready and they'd finally come to church. The grandmother, the great-grandmother, all she did was corral them through the church service over and over. And I thought, who would go? Y'all have heard me share about this church. They've been without a pastor now 11 years. Nobody wants to go there. It doesn't have air conditioning. It doesn't have cell phone service. The only electricity that is there is when they get the generator to run. When we were there, we used our generator on our bus to power all of our sound equipment. And we set everything up just like this. That way it looked like we didn't want them to think that we were coming in there halfway, because they deserve the best, because Jesus Christ died. So we should give our best. We got there, and Stephen, being the sound guru that he is, he took two speakers, extra speakers we carry in the bus. He put one at the front of the bus and one at the back of the bus. So every day, about 3 hours before service would start, he made a commercial while he was up there. Revival at the Watek Church tonight at 6 p.m. Come on.
Crusaders and Brother Marvin.
That's it. And he would play that commercial, and then he'd play praise and worship, Southern Gospel. So it was just, I'm talking about going all over that village, you know. And the first night, there was three folks there.
Amen.
Three people besides us four. Total seven. That was on Friday night. Saturday night, a few more. So we went through Tuesday night. Tuesday night, there was 21. Several of the ladies there, one of them had just moved back from outside of Oklahoma City. She had moved back to be with her mom. Her mom was 91 or 92, and you're not going to, I mean, this is amazing to me. She would walk to church because she didn't have a car. And she was 91 when we were there. And to walk to church was over a mile. Now, it wasn't flat ground either. She'd have to come off the hills, and I'm talking about steep trails. And she'd walk to church. She was faithful to be there every time the doors was open. And so her house sets up there, and so she lived by herself. And so she had a little step stool made to get up into her top cabinets, and she slipped on the step and fell, and it messed up her hip. And now this woman at 91 would climb trees. When the trees would get in the way of her satellite receiver, because she couldn't see the preaching on her TV, she operated on a solar panel, she would climb the tree and cut the limbs out of the way. 91 years old. She would get on top of her house and sweep the pine straw off. But no one wants to go. No one wants to go. Brother Marvin, he told us when we got there, he said, it'll be one of two things. You'll either, you can't wait to get out of here, or you can't wait to get back. Now, the first few days for Stephen, it was, I can't wait to get out of here. He got really scared because Penny and I kept saying, well, we don't have to be anywhere for a couple of weeks. We'll just stay a couple of weeks. But I guess it was what, probably Monday? Monday he realized that life does go on. And he asked us when he came back, he said, are we going back to California this year? Because our desire is to go back and to stay longer. Because the chief gave us permission to come at any point in time and stay as long as we wanted to stay. And they say that's unheard of. The guy that pastored the church there in Hoopa, he is a Native American. And when he found out, because I called him and asked him, could we park the bus there? Because I wasn't sure that I could get it back in to the other reservation. He said, how did you get in there? And I said, what do you mean? He said, I've been here over 2 years, and I've been trying to get back there, and they won't approve me to go back there and preach. How did you get back there? I said, Jesus.
Yeah.
That's all I know. It was just Jesus.
Yeah.
And so we developed a friendship with him. We ended up getting to carry the bus back there. Because I told them, they said, well, the roads are curvy. I said, man, I'm from Arkansas. You ain't seen curvy roads. And so we went back there. And our prayer is that God will allow us to go back this year. And we'd like to stay a little longer. Stephen and I and Penny, we would work every day. We got there on Thursday evening, Friday morning, we got up. And let me tell you how good God is. Do you know how good God is? Do you know that God sees things before you even think of them?
Right.
So we had finished the revival the week prior in San Francisco with our friend Brother Marvin at his church. Well, along with us, Brother Marvin enjoyed doing something that we did, yard selling. Man, I like to go yard selling. Penny likes to go yard selling. Stephen even likes to go yard selling. And to have somebody to drive you around, man, that's like it. And he had a truck. So if you found something big, you know, we could figure out how we could tear it apart and put it in the bay of the bus. So we're at this house, and it's a nice house, big two-story house, and they're having a good yard sale. I'm talking about if we'd have lived closer, we could have cleaned up. So we're walking through there, and I saw this weed eater over there, Brother Andy. It was a nice craftsman. It was a four-stroke. I said, well, ain't that something? I said, you ain't got to mix gas. And so I looked at it. The guy had $40 on it. It looked brand new. And I said, well, I'm out here in California. What am I going to do with a weed eater? So I walked away from it. And Penny, she said, you see that weed eater? And I said, yeah, I certainly did. She said, do you need it? And I said, no, I got two at the house. What am I going to do? She said, well, you got a son. Doesn't he need one? I said, oh, yeah, yeah. So I went back and asked the guy. I said, what do you take for the weed eater? And he said, oh, I'll take 35. I said, how about I give you 25? And we haggled a little bit there. And he said, okay. I said, throw in the roll of string, too. Brand new roll of string. So he said, okay, carry it. So I thought, what are we going to do with a weed eater, you know? So we put a trash bag around the motor, slid it up in the bottom of the bunk. So here we are. We get up there to the reservation. They had some of the biggest blackberries you ever seen in your life. There was a picture, I think, up on there. Penny made blackberry cobblers over and over up there. And I'm telling you, they were good. And, you know, the bears had even come up and eat them real close to the house. And because they left a sign. And so we're up there, and I look down the steps off the back of the parsonage. The parsonage is on the side of a hill, and it's got this beautiful deck that hangs out up over it. Now, this parsonage is not a brick home. It's a skyline 1977 14x60 mobile home. Now, Skyline, now this blew my mind. Skyline's built in Bossier City, Louisiana, and it's all the way out in California. That's got to be a good trailer. So it's built into a house and everything. They built some in it. And, you know, it's nice. Doesn't have no electricity. They even got lights, but they have a battery system that when somebody was there, they would solar and generator and this and that. So we're there, and I saw these vines and brushes and everything. I thought, man, I'm going to have me a good time, because there's nothing like cutting when you can just take out your frustration. Give me a swing blade. Man, I can get with it. After about 3 minutes with a swing blade, I said, man, I wished I had a weed eater. I said, I do. It's in the bus. And I said, oh, man, I ain't got no gas. And Brother Marvin said, I got 5 gallons in the back of the truck. God provided. So me and Stephen, for 2 days solid, we used that weed eater cleaning and working around that church and around cleaning up. So I wanted you to know tonight. We talked about this passage of scripture in the book of Isaiah 3, verse 8, I believe it says, and it says, and the Lord said, who will go for us? And he says, here am I, send me.
Amen.
So your seeds are going out. I wanted you to know, Penny wanted you to know, Stephen wanted you to know, that we wanted you to see just a portion tonight of where everything is going.
Right.
Amen?
Amen.
So I say thank you in advance of what you're going to do, because you cannot outgive God.
Right.
If you sow a little, you reap a little. If you sow a lot, you reap a lot. It's God's math. Don't try to figure out God's math. Just trust it.
Right.
Because it works. Amen?
Right.
Amen. Well, are you excited tonight about the Word of God?
Amen.
Amen. I am. And what does Jesus mean to you? What does he mean to you? There was a song that Phil Cross wrote, He Means the World to Me. And so I ask you this question, does he mean the world to you tonight? Well, Jesus means that I got to go to church. Well, if that's what he means to you, that's not a very good definition of who he is. I really want you to think about that for just a moment. I will go ahead and turn to the book of John, chapter 6, and verse 69. And we'll get there in just a moment. If you're child was to come up to you and ask you, say, Daddy, what does this mean to you? How would you describe him? If your daughter was to come up to you, Mom, and say, Mom, what does Jesus mean to you? How would you describe him? If your friend came up to you and said, you talk about Jesus, but what does he mean to you? How would you describe him? Could you give an accurate description of what he means in your life? This afternoon, I begin to think about that. I begin to think about who Jesus Christ is to me. I know everybody's first answer is, oh, he's my Savior. Whenever the Lord God told Moses, and he said, well, who do I tell them that sent me? He said, you tell them I am.
Right.
When you take that word, three letters, I am, I am, it encompasses everything.
Right.
But who is Jesus to you? How would you describe him? And tonight, we're going to go through some things tonight that my prayer is when you leave here, that your description of Jesus will be so much more, that you'll be willing to serve him more than you've ever wanted to serve him, that your desire to serve him will turn up so hot, it'll jump to a new level.
Right.
It'll change from an old to a brand new. And that your passion be for Jesus Christ. Give me 20 minutes with you and I can find out what your passion is.
That's right.
Some of you, it might only take 5. Because whatever you're passionate about, that's what you're going to talk about. You're passionate for Jesus tonight. Would you stand in honor of the reading of God's Word? We're going to read one verse. John chapter 6 and verse 69, we find at this very point in Scripture, in the particular account, the disciples that had been walking with Jesus, there was many at that point in time, and a disciple is a follower of Christ. I pray that you are a follower of Christ tonight. But some of these decided to go back. My friend, I don't want to go back to the way I was. I have no desire to return to the old life. I'm going to follow Jesus. And so we find as it begins to take place, Jesus is coming up, and the disciples, let's just start at 66, and let's read through it in that way. It says, from that time, many of his disciples went back and walked with him no more. Oh, my. What do you think they're saying today? Where are they today? Jesus said to the 12. Now, remember the 12 that Jesus handpicked. Do you also want to go away? So I ask you tonight, standing here in Green Valley Baptist Church, as we're standing at this very point at 7:25, do you want to go away? Do you want to go back to the old lifestyle? Do you want to walk away from God? But Simon Peter answered him and said, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. Right there, we ought to be shouting the roof off.
That's right, amen.
We ought to just be up off of this place right now, because Jesus Christ has the words of eternal life. He is the way, the truth, and the life, and no man's going to get into heaven except through him, and that's it. That's it. 69. Simon Peter, old bullheaded Peter talking right here. I think he's pretty humbled at this point. Also, we have come to believe and know that you are the Christ, the Son of the living God.
Amen.
Let's pray. Father, I thank you for your word. God, I thank you for the songs of praise that we've had tonight. God, I thank you for every individual that has took time to be here tonight. God, I ask you to be with those that are traveling tonight, God. Lord, that are working tonight, that wanted to be here. God, I pray you'd be with them, keep them safe, and bless them. And Lord, I just ask you right now, Lord, that we would just tune the world out. The world, but we would tune you in. And Lord, that we want to hear from you tonight. God, we want to walk out changed. We want to walk out for God, a passion for the cross and compassion for the lost. Lord, we want to change tonight. We want to be more for you than we've ever been. And Lord, we want a revival like we've never had. God, we want that fresh breath that just causes us to gasp so deep, to breathe in every of you. So I pray tonight, Lord, you have your way tonight. God, I pray for those who are wrestling with salvation tonight. I pray for those who are wrestling with depression. And Lord, in all of the junk that Satan throws, God, I just ask you, Lord, to those that are hurting tonight, Lord, there's been that's mentioned that they have physical ailments. And so, Lord, we stand and believe and know that you are the great physician. And so, Lord, right now, speak to us and have your way in Jesus' name. And everybody said,
amen.
Amen. You may be seated. So how would you describe Jesus if someone was to come up and ask you? There's a lot of talk about the disciples. And we talk about the 12. There's a lot that goes on. And it was neat the way the Lord recalled some things to me as I sat there in front of the computer and I began to think about the passion. I don't mind getting in that bus and going, yes, I'm learning that. When you start getting in that mid-50 range, that your body begins to tire out. It begins to hurt. You begin to wake up in the mornings and feel things you've never felt.
Amen.
And sometimes you say, where did that come from? I didn't know it was attached to my body. But what is it that drives an individual to spend hours getting to a place and telling somebody about Jesus? What is it that drives you to the place to tell your grandkids about Jesus? What is it that drives you to tell your husband over and over, or your wife over and over, even though they get mad, about Jesus? What is that that drives you? I want to say the disciples for just a moment. Now, you talk about, everybody says, well, those were the disciples that Jesus handpicked, and that Jesus foreknew that they were going to be great men of God, and there was all of this. You can get into all this theological discussion, but when it boils down to one thing, they were a man, you and I.
Right.
They were born the same way. They grew up the same way. They learned the same way. They were ordinary men doing extraordinary things. But what is it that drives you? Would you say that you would be like James? James only lived, he was killed in 44 or 45 AD. So it wasn't long after Jesus had ascended. James, the Lord, was the second recorded martyr after Christ's death. Stephen was the first. Stephen was stoned. His death is recorded in the book of Acts, where it says, Herod Agrippa, he killed James, the brother of John, with a sword. And it says the executioner, get a load of this, what drives you to Jesus Christ to tell others? It says in this, it says that it is reported after seeing the courage and the unrecanting spirit of James, the executioner was so convinced of Christ's resurrection that he was executed with him. What drives you tonight? Would you say you have that kind of drive to tell others about Jesus Christ? To go and tell somebody? My friend, when you begin to start reading the accounts of the disciples and the apostles and how that they were martyred for Jesus Christ, it begins to make me question who I am. Do I do enough? Do I do enough? Peter was the second. Peter, although he denied Christ three times, just before the resurrection, he was willing to be martyred for his belief. Peter thought himself unworthy to be crucified in the same as his master, so he asked to be crucified head down. Well, you know, I've been a member of the church since it was instituted here, and we open the doors, and I've done this, and I've done that. I don't think I've heard nobody say, I want to be crucified upside down. I mean, who are we?
Right.
I'm not trying to belittle anything that you're doing. I just want us to get a good, clear picture. Where's your passion at?
Right.
How would you describe Jesus Christ? I will assure you that these men had no problem describing Jesus Christ. And if you're born again and know Jesus Christ, you should have no problem describing who Jesus is in your life.
That's right, amen.
You should have no problem. Andrew, the brother of Peter, was martyred 6 years after Peter. After preaching Christ's resurrection, he was crucified for his faith. Andrew was hanged on an olive tree. Six years after his brother. Can I tell you that Peter and Andrew and James and John were pretty wealthy folks? Can I tell you, because they owned a fishing business, they had workers, they had boats, and fish was a major, major income. So they didn't have to take off following Jesus. They could have sat at home, lived in their nice house, probably lived out a full life. Something drew them.
Right.
What draws you tonight? What draws you to tell others about Jesus Christ? Thomas, old doubting Thomas. My friend, when he touched those scarred hands and put his hand in the side of Jesus, he fell to his feet. And my friend, he went out. He didn't go out quietly. Thomas was known as Doubting Thomas because of the recollection to the belief of the other apostles witnessing the resurrection. Thomas states, "Unless I see the hands, the marks of the nails, and place my finger into the mark of the nails and place my hand in his side, I will never believe." After this, Christ appeared to Thomas, and he believed until death. Oh, and by the way, it says, Thomas, blessed is because you've seen, but blessed are those who have not seen, but yet believe. So we're blessed when we believe upon the Lord Jesus Christ. And so we find at this point, Thomas believed up until his unto death. Thomas sealed his testimony as he was thrust with a pine spear, tormented with red hot plates, and burned alive. You say, "Well, Brother David, you kind of getting a little gory tonight." No, I'm just upset. We want revival. We need to understand what our passion is. Our passion is going and telling others about Jesus Christ, telling what God has done in our life. My friend, if you don't have a testimony, get saved.
Right. Amen.
Amen goes after that, y'all. You don't have a testimony about how Jesus has changed your life, get saved.
Right.
That's the bottom line. Because you can't talk about something you don't know. If you don't know what Jesus has done for you, get saved. These men knew what Jesus did for them. They didn't have a problem of standing up. We've been studying Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Those three men didn't have a problem standing up to King Nebuchadnezzar and told him, said, "Look, King, we have no need to even answer your threats. Let it be known. We're not going to bend, bow, or break to your God.
Amen.
We're going to serve the Lord." So we find Thomas, Doubting Thomas. The next is Philip. Saw the glory of Christ after his resurrection and undoubtedly amazed at Christ's response to his request, Philip evangelizes all of Phrygia, where hostile Jews had him tortured and crucified. Now listen to that. God's chosen people, the Jews, took Philip and had him tortured and killed. Kind of sounds like the church today, doesn't it? Now, what are they doing here? What are they? I can't believe that they have the courage to come in this church after the way they did. That's what we do to our injured.
Right.
If we get our eyes off of them and put them on Jesus Christ and get a passion for Jesus Christ, I want to assure you, we'll be inviting whoever. We'll go get them. We'll go knock on their door and we'll pray for them. Matthew was a tax collector. Levi was his name before he met Jesus. Levi was a very wealthy man. He was very young. He left, became a tax collector. His history was his dad was a tanner of skins, and so when his dad would go to buy product to tan the skins, he would go with him. And he would see that his dad would have to stop and pay a tax to the tax collector. Well, nobody liked the tax collector, but the tax collector was the man who was making the money. The tax collector didn't like the Romans either. So something about that appealed to Levi, and he could see that there was a way that he could make a good living. So Levi leaves home, goes to the school, becomes a tax collector at a very young age, and also has a providence that he is over at a very young age, has a lot of people working for him. And so we find that Levi hears that Jesus is in town. And he hears about Jesus teaching on a hillside. Levi was very gifted at penning. He could pen very accurately and very fast. And so he would write down what Jesus spoke. Listen to me. When you begin to read the Bible, you can't help but get changed. So here is a tax collector that nobody likes, sitting up there, writing down, penning things, and begins to realize who Jesus is. The Bible says that Levi was at the desk of the collector, sitting in his office, if you will, and Jesus comes by and sticks his head in and says, "Come follow me." The Bible says immediately, he pushed the chair back, stood up, took off. Didn't look back. Find that that night you find that he did have a great feast at his home and invited all of his friends. Isn't that amazing? That's called evangelism. Right. Evangelism. He went and got his friends and said, come and listen to this man. And then there was them Pharisees that was peeping through the windows. Ah, look there. They sat in there and eat with them sinners. Sinners. But Matthew, a follower of Jesus Christ, took a stand. It says he wrote the gospel, according to Matthew, about 10 years before his death. Within the pages, one can see the faith in which he spilled his blood. These comforting words likely sustained Matthew when he was beheaded. Lo, I'm with you always, even till the end of the age. Matthew. How would you describe Jesus? Nathanael. Nathanael, whose name means gift of God, was truly given as a gift to the church. Nathanael was the first to profess Christ. Later, he paid for this profession through a hideous death. Unwilling to recant his proclamation of the risen Christ, he was filleted alive and then crucified. Oh, Brother David, I'm so busy at the church. I do so much for the church. These men suffered. Now, these are just the disciples. This goes through the ages, my friend. It's still happening today. James the Lesser. It says that he was cast down from the temple, that he was beaten to death with a fuller club after the fall. Beaten to death. To force James to deny Christ's resurrection, these men positioned him at the top of the temple in Jerusalem. Unwilling to deny what he knew to be true, James was cast down from the temple, finally beaten to death with a club to his head. Simon the Zealot. Simon was a Jewish zealot who strived to set the people free from the Roman oppression. And after he saw with his own eyes that Christ had been resurrected, he became a zealot of the gospel. Historians tell many places that Simon proclaimed the good news of Christ's resurrection. He was martyred for Christ because his testimony in Syria. Judas, Thaddeus, not Iscariot, because we know what happened to Judas Iscariot. After he witnessed Christ's resurrection, Judas knew the answer. He preached the risen Christ in the pagan priest in Mesopotamia, and he was eventually beaten to death with the sticks, showing to the world that Christ was indeed Lord and God. Matthias is believed to be one of the 70 Christ sent out during the early ministry. Qualified him to be an apostle, Matthias is one of the least known. He preached in Ethiopia and was later stoned while hanging upon a cross. John. He was not martyred. John was the only one of the 12 who died a natural death. Although he did not die a martyr's death, he lived a martyr's life. He was exiled on the Isle of Patmos during the reign of Emperor Dionysius and his proclamation of the risen Christ. And it was there that he wrote the last book in the Bible, Revelation. Some traditions say that he was thrown into a boiling oil before the Latin gate. While it did not kill him, it likely scarred him for life. Paul was not one of the original 12. Paul was a self-confessed persecutor of Christian faith, as he states in Galatians. Paul was brought to repentance as he traveled down Damascus. Ironically, he was on his way to arrest those who held to Jesus' resurrection. Paul started as a great skeptic, but spent the rest of his life proclaiming the Christ persecuted. He went through so much. He was shipwrecked, beaten many times, through all sorts of hardships. It says, finally, Paul met his death at the hands of Emperor Nero and was beheaded in Rome. What does Jesus mean to you? Who is he? How do you describe him? It's time that we get down where the rubber meets the road. If you can't have a description in your life of what Jesus Christ has done in your life, there's no relationship.
Right.
There's no relationship. Penny and I celebrated 34 years. Is that right? Well, I know both of us go back and say 82, 83.
Yeah.
But if we never were married and I never would have met my beautiful wife from Shongaloo, Louisiana, while I was standing on a ladder in Magic Mart, hanging a sign up, and I saw her pass by. If I saw somebody passing, if she'd have just passed by, I knew her name, but I wouldn't have knew her heart. We never would have had a relationship. We wouldn't have grown together. You cannot have a relationship with somebody that you don't know. It just does not happen. Don't let Satan fool you. Well, I go to church. That's good. Satan goes to church too. Some of you bring him with him. He comes in with you.
Amen.
Just going to be honest. You ask me how I know? Look at the smile on your face. It ain't there. Says, the joy of the Lord is my strength. I'm not talking about a hard day, going through things, life as it happens. But my friend, when we get into the presence of God and we start worshiping the King of Kings, There's got to be some type of change in a facial expression, because if you don't let your faith know, probably your heart don't know.
Right.
So I ask you, how would you describe Jesus Christ? What is he to you? I just went through 13 different men that were sold out, didn't bend, didn't break, didn't give in. How would you describe him? What he's done in your life? Could you describe your life? My question right there is, if you don't know how to describe him, you probably hadn't met him. I just want to be honest with you tonight. I'd have you not be ignorant of the gospel. That's what Paul says. The gospel is this, is that Jesus Christ, the Son of God, came from heaven, was willing to come, born as a babe in a manger of a virgin. He grew up, walked a sinless life. For 3.5 years, he walked on the face of this earth in his ministry, telling the world, preaching that the kingdom of God is at hand and that he's coming again, and preached that if he was the way, the truth, and the life. Then he was beaten beyond recognition. He was scourged. Most folks never survive scourgings. The bulk who were scourged before being crucified, they did not survive it. They would die of infection and other things because their organs were exposed from the flesh being ripped from their body. And then to be crucified because he loves us so very much, was willing. Do you understand? This is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and he has all authority, the Bible says, in heaven and earth and below. And all he would have had to done was say, "Father, come get me." Just like that. Legions upon legions upon legions of angels come down, and this earth would have been just a smoke screen. And they would have ushered Jesus back into the presence of heaven and ministered to him. And my friend, you and I would probably not be here. But he was willing to go through it and to follow through with the pain and the agony and all of that happened on that gruesome day, being mocked. How many of you like to be mocked? Yeah, nobody likes. How would you like to be slapped in the face and say, "Prophesy, who hit you?" Have a crown of thorns drove down and be beat with a rod. I don't think there's anybody in here who would like that. But yet he endured it. He stood before Pilate, and Pilate said, "Man, you better speak. Don't you know I have the authority to set you free or to pronounce you guilty?" He said, "You only have what's been given to you." Because he was thinking of you. He was thinking of me at that very point. So you ask me, how can I describe Jesus? He's my great I am.
That's right. Amen.
He's my beginning and end, the Alpha and Omega. He's my bread of life. He's my provider. He's my healer. He's a friend that sticketh closer than a brother. He's that light in the darkest day. He's that calm on a rough sea. He's that cool drink on a thirsty afternoon. Oh, I want to tell you, if you can't describe him, if I could beg you, I'd do it. I'd beg you to come get saved and taste the drink of that living water of what these men were willing to go and to do and to give their lives. How many folks was in the military in here? Okay? Amen. Well, did you take an oath to protect the country, to die for it? Yeah. It's a shame that we won't take an oath to live for Jesus Christ.
That's right. Amen.
It's a shame that we won't go to the standard. This earth will burn up and pass away. But eternity is forever. This life is like a vapor. It appeareth for a moment and then it's gone. my grandmother used to say, I'd say, Nanny, I sure wished it was my birthday. Nanny, I sure wished it was Christmas. She'd say, Dave, you're wishing your life away. She said, one day you're going to wake up, it's Monday morning. When you go to bed, it's Friday evening. I know what that means. Life speeds up.
Yeah.
It's a vapor. Time's speeding away. It's getting late. Huh. Some folks plan to get saved at midnight and die 5 minutes to midnight. They're going to wait till the last minute. These men didn't wait. How would you describe Jesus? What is he to you? Is he a cigar god? Let me this. Remember the cigar boxes? Used to would store stuff in those, important documents, because there was a thick box that had a heavy lid. And then when you needed it, you go up and you get it and you take it down. And there was always good stuff inside there. Those cigar boxes. I never smoked, but I saw those cigar boxes because my grandparents had a lot of them. Is that what God is to you? You just place him up on a shelf, and then when you need him, you go get him, take him down? No, that's a genie. Oh, and by the way, God ain't Santa Claus. He's the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords.
Right.
Oh, and he ain't the Easter Bunny either. He ain't hopping after nobody. But he will run to you. He'll run to you if you call out to him. Who is Jesus? How would you describe him? I challenge you, when you get home, y'all take a pen and paper and sit down and write down what Jesus is to you. And then look at it. If you're here tonight and you've never met Jesus Christ, you might say, well, Dave, this has been pretty rough tonight. Oh, well, take it up with God. I did what he told me to do.
Right.
And by the way, I will have to give an account for every word that I preach.
That's right.
Because I heard the call. So you don't think this old boy wants to be obedient? Huh. I want to do what he tells me to do. This church is so special to us, and I would be selling you out short if I didn't tell you what God told me to tell you.
Right.
If Brother Andy didn't preach what God placed upon his heart Sunday night and Wednesday night, if he didn't do that, he'd be doing you an injustice. He'd be selling you out short. It's time that we get past our little pity feelings about things and we realize there's more to it than just sitting down and saying, oh, he hurt my feelings today. He didn't even shake my hand today. I cannot even believe that when I came in the door, he looked the other way. It's time that we move on from that and realize that there are folks that died that were filleted alive and then stoned to death, that were spear and the hot plates put on them for the cause of Jesus Christ. And we're going to worry about somebody not shaking our hand? Come on, church. Come on, it's time that we get real. Folks are dying and going to hell. Since we have been inside this building, thousands upon thousands upon thousands of people have bursted hell. That preacher was right. I wished I would have listened. The rich man, he called back and he called to Abraham and he said, look, just send somebody back to tell him that, just if I could just go back and tell him. He said, look, we can't do it. There's a great gulf that's fixed. And once it's over with, folks.
Right.
There ain't no middle spot for somebody to pray you out of. It's either heaven or hell.
Right.
And if you don't make a choice for heaven, hell it is. Well, you trying to scare us. I wished I could. Because I wouldn't want my worst enemy going to hell. The Bible begins to talk about it. Gnashing of teeth. Where the worm dieth not. The thirst is not quenched. Fire and brimstone. agony forever and ever and ever. These folks that say, well, it don't make a hill of beans to me. I got friends in hell. I got friends in heaven. I'm going to party wherever I'm at. No, you're wrong.
Right. Preaching.
You are wrong. Why, the worm died not. My friend, heaven is real.
Amen.
And hell is real. And these men were willing, because of Jesus Christ, to give every last bit of energy to tell the world that Jesus Christ defeated death, hell, and the grave, and he rose again. And you have the opportunity to accept a free gift of salvation and to come to him and realize that he can give you eternal life. What is it that's holding you back tonight? My prayer is that nothing will tonight. This is Thursday night. Time's running out. I'm not talking about the service getting over with. I'm talking about time is drawing near.
Right, amen.
My friend, our Lord is coming. Now, I'm a little excited about that.
Right.
I'm all right about that.
Yeah.
But there's folks that's in this room that's not all right. In this little church in Green Valley, you need to accept Jesus tonight. How would you describe him? Would you bow your heads? Stephen, just hold off on you tonight. It's 8 o'clock. But my friend, I want you to know something. We are not promised the next breath. So what's keeping you tonight? What's keeping you from accepting that free gift? You don't think you need it? Well, I'll just be the same as I was. These men that we just read about, they were not the same after they met Jesus. And as you stand before the mirror of God, what change is there in your life? So tonight, if you're here and you've never asked Jesus into your heart and life to be your Lord and Savior, I want to ask you this tonight. I'm serious. If everybody would please just, this is serious business. If you don't believe me, go ask Peter. Go ask Andrew. It's serious business. Go ask Jesus. So tonight, while your head is bowed, and you'd say, Brother David, I'm just not really sure about where I'd spend eternity. I'm not sure if I would go to heaven or I'd go to hell. I'm just not sure about it. If that's you tonight, real quietly, would you just slip your hand up? I'd like to pray for you that you're just not sure tonight where you'd spend eternity. Please don't be embarrassed. It's so serious, folks. It is so serious that you'd say, I'm just really not sure tonight. And I'd like for you to pray for me that I can get a clear vision of it. I'm just not sure. I want to be sure tonight. Thank you. Anybody else? Anybody else? Get real. It's time to get real. Anybody else tonight, say, I'm just not sure tonight. Doesn't matter about your age. What matters is your heart and your soul. And you say, Brother David, I've wrestled with this, and I'm ready to make a decision. Oh, do I have good news? If you've listened to the Lord, and you've heard Him knock at your heart's door, and you keep rejecting Him, and as Stephen stood last night, and he with you, and you wrote it off because you thought Satan was trying to trick you. Yeah, he wants to trick you, all right. He wants you to think you're okay. But my friend, that still small voice that knocks and says, come unto me and I'll give you rest. That's the one you listen to. That's the one right there. So right there where you're sitting tonight, in this stillness right now, because there's some hearts that's beating really fast. You feel like it's going to beat outside your chest here in just a moment. Why don't you just ask Jesus right there where you're at? He's listening right now. See, because He knows your heart. And by the way, it's okay. So if that's you, why don't you just pray right now? Pray with me. Pray in faith, believing. You ask Him right there, because He can hear a whisper all the way to heaven. Right now, if that's you, just pray, dear Lord Jesus, I know that I am a sinner. And Lord Jesus, I believe that You died once again. And right now, You're in heaven. Lord, I am lost. Lord, would You come into my heart and life? Forgive me of my sins. Lord, save me. Thank You, Lord, for saving my soul. Now I want to live the rest of my life serving You. Now, with your heads bowed, your eyes closed for just a moment, just a quick moment, right then, if you prayed that prayer right then and you heard the Holy Spirit speaking to you, drawing you, and you answered Him and you prayed that prayer and you asked Jesus right then into your heart, I want you to slip your hand up real high. That you asked Jesus into your heart right then. You meant business about it. Okay, if you meant business about it, I want you just to stand up right where you're at. You meant business that you asked Jesus right then in your life. Stand up right there where you're at. Folks are still praying. Heads are still bowed. You just stand up. It's all good. I promise you that. You asked Jesus right then. Right then. Now I want to ask you this. And you'd say, Brother David, I'd like for you to pray for me because I want to be able to tell folks what Jesus means to me in my life. And I want a closer walk than I've ever had with Him before. Remember, we're talking revival here. And you may have already raised your hand this week, but my friend, I raise mine every day because I want a closer walk with Jesus. So if that's you tonight and you'd say, Brother David, would you pray for me? I just want to serve Him more. Amen. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much. And you didn't raise it for me. You raised it for the Lord. Now, while we're sitting right here, and you'd say, Brother David, I've got family that's lost. Would you slip your hand up? Thank you. Thank you. Hands all over. So I ask you, you raise that hand, have you told Him what Jesus means to you? Have you gone to Him and told Him what Jesus means to you? Maybe tonight you'd like to come and just rededicate your life. Now let me help you right here. And you'd say, I've kind of walked away from God. I'm just not serving Him the way that I once was. And I realize, I want to get back in full fellowship with God. I want to be going the same direction that he's going. But my friend, you can't rededicate something you've never had. You can't rededicate a church baptism or membership because that don't mean nothing. If you've never had a relationship with Jesus Christ, you can't rededicate something you don't have. Maybe you just say, Brother David, I want to get and I want to walk after God like never before. So I'm rededicating and I want to serve you, Lord. I'm going to follow you. Just a moment. We want to give you that opportunity. Once again, we're talking revival here. Some of us need to be reminded of who we're serving and why we're serving. Because of what he did on Calvary. What's he speaking to you about tonight? In this stillness. Remember, sometimes we just need to get quiet and listen to the Lord. Did you ask him to save you tonight? Did you realize you was lost and you needed a Savior? I'm just a little scared, Brother David. I'm just a little scared to take that step. Well, I will assure you this much. If you'll take a step towards Jesus, he'll move you the rest of the way. I'll assure you of that. I will assure you of that. Father, right now, you know the hearts. You know every heart that's pleading, every heart that's beating fast at this moment. Lord, you know everything that is happening at this very time. So I ask you, Lord, may we be obedient to do what you're leading us to do. And I pray for those that you'd give them strength, that you would give them a boldness to take a step to you. And Lord, those that are hurting tonight, God, I just pray that reach out to the great physician. So Lord, I ask you right now in this invitation time, I ask you, Lord, would you have your way? And God, may we get out of the way and be obedient to what you've told us to do. In Jesus' name. Would you stand? I'm going to ask Brother Andy, he's going to be down here. I want Penny down here and I want Stephen over here. Miss Janet, would you come down also? Whatever it is that God is dealing with you about tonight, would you surrender it all to him? Dad, maybe you just need to take that family member by the hand and bring him down to the altar and say, I want to pray for you. Hurt's done got so much that you just can't hardly deal with it anymore. Why don't you bring it to God and surrender it all over to him? Whatever it is, would you surrender all? Every bit.
Lord, and I surrender.
ago and said that you have loved ones that are lost. You may have been to this altar a thousand times crying out their name. What about one more? You want to be obedient, you be obedient to God tonight. You raised your hand a while ago signifying that you had somebody. I encourage you, find you a place down here and pray right now. Pray for that loved one right now. Call out their name. Call their name. Right there where you're at, I'm going to ask you to do something. While these are praying, they're praying for individuals. I want you to look at the individual beside you. And I want you to dead eye them. I'm talking about look them eyeball to eyeball and ask them, if you were to die, where would you spend eternity? Heaven or hell? And if you get an answer that says, I hope, there's a good possibility, or maybe I really want to, you say, come on, let's go get that right tonight. Look at them. It's real. Eternity's real, folks. Eternity is real. If they can't answer heaven for sure, take them by the hand and bring them down here. Brother Andy's over here. Stephen's over here. Penny's here. Right now. It's serious, church.
Sing.
Seat real quiet, please. We've got people still praying and all. The Lord is really moving in our midst here. People are making decisions, and that's why we have revival. You know, what is a few minutes in light of eternity? And what's a few more minutes in light of maybe your neighbor getting saved as you continue to pray for them, that brother or sister, aunt, uncle, mom or dad, someone in your family getting saved? October 1982, that the Lord saved me. Jesus is everything to me.
Come on now.
He's everything. Romans 3:23, the Word of God says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Me, it's everybody here. Romans 6:23 says, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. That death is talking about a spiritual death. That death there means you will be eternally separated from God because of your decision to reject His Son Jesus as your Lord and your Savior. Think about that tonight. Romans 5:8, the Word of God says, but God commendeth His love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Oh, how He loves you and me. That thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised Him from the dead, thou shalt be saved.
Amen.
Woo! I like Amen. That. We're all good. It's all the saved folks. We really get excited when we talk about getting saved, don't we?
That's
yeah.
It.
If you can't get excited about these verses tonight, it could be you're not saved.
That's
you need
fine.
To get saved. Romans 10:13, the Word of God says, for whosoever,
Amen.
Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved.
Praise the Lord.
Whosoever. That whosoever was me in October 1982, is that whosoever you tonight, is that you? Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Giant plans burdened me because God's entrusted the souls of so many people to us. Hearing me. He's entrusted the souls of the lost people we work around, lost people in our family, lost people we know and see and everything. He's entrusted their souls to us. That's why Brother Stephen preached to me, salt and light. Don't have enough salt in them to cure out an old Kentucky ham. What bothers me? We need to be the saltiest Christians there ever was. In light. Wow. So many Christians have let so much darkness get to their light that their light doesn't shine anymore. That cannot be us. Wow. Is everything well? Coming to church will be tomorrow night. Then tickle them, make them laugh, you know, do it in love. Get them in here.
Amen.
You get them in here, and they're on what God will do.
That's right.
But you got to get them here. All right. Turn to your neighbor and say, I love you in the Lord. Turn to your neighbor and say, the Lord.
I love you, the Lord.
Amen. You know, love is the greatest force in the universe. Mm-hmm. The greatest force in the universe. Now, we know you newlyweds love each other.
Hey, I'm still a newlywed.
Amen. Amen. All right. Where's the ushers? While everybody's happy, it's a good time to pick up an offering.
Amen.
Thank y'all for being here tonight. God bless y'all. Don't forget. Thank you. Don't forget, 6 o'clock tomorrow evening, we'll have a memorial service for Brother Aaron's daughter right here. Be here. Brother Aaron's going to be taking care of that. Pray for him. Pray for him that the Lord will give him strength. And then he's ordered pizza for us to eat over the new building. And he's ordered a lot of pizza, so I'm going to pig out. His daughter's favorite food was pizza. So while we eat pizza, we'll remember his daughter and remember his family. And Brother Aaron, Chloe, we love y'all. You got something you want? Hold on, I got a microphone.
I just want to thank every one of you for your kindness and your love and your support. I want to thank the Crusaders. They've been a big help in this period of time. And there's 50 pizzas after the revival service. They're right over there in that building. And you probably need to take a few of them home with you.
Amen, brother. And thank you. God bless you. We're praying for y'all's family.
Amen.
Let's bow our heads. Father God, thank you so much for everything that you do for us, Father. The big things, the little things. Father, we thank you for everything that you do. The air we breathe, the water we drink, on our back. Father, what you do for us. And thank you most of all for your Son, Jesus Christ, who is my Lord and my Savior. My all in all, he's everything to me. Thank you, Father, for everyone who's here. I pray, Lord, that you'll continue to move in the hearts and lives of everyone here. And I pray, Lord, that you'll use us to win the lost all around this church, all around where we live, all around where we work, all around where we go. Thank you, Father, for the messages we've been hearing. Thank you, Father, for the Word of God. And we thank you, Father, for those who give. And Father, I pray, Lord, that you'll just help us to give sacrificially. And we'll give everything that you told us to give, Lord. Bless this time now. Bless this money, Lord. Bless the Crusaders as they go. We love you, Father. And we ask these things in Jesus' precious, holy, wonderful name. Amen.
Amen.
Love y'all.